Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the penultimate Archaeology in Action, our lecture in the series concerned with the North Pontic region. Today's speaker is Professor Monica Marguerite, who is best known in European archaeology as a specialist in hard osseous material, bone, antler, and tooth tools and ornaments. She started her academic studies as with a BA in the Valahia University of Târgoviște in Romania. She obviously found Târgoviște to her taste, since she has been studied and worked there ever since, with the exception of her technical formation at the Sorbonne and at the Upper Paleolithic site of Pincemont, with postdoc at Aix-en-Provence, excuse my French, in 2009 and 2010. She became a lecturer in Târgoviște in 2005, completing her PhD in 2008 with promotion to associate professor in 2015 and a full professorship in 2020. Appearing in international as well as Romanian journals, Monica's publication ranged from her special research on bone and antler tools and ornaments from the Paleolithic to the Iron Age, looking at both settlement and cemetery assemblages, to more popular books on ethnology, as well as cave and portable Paleolithic art, co-authored with Marinka Jumaru. She has synthesized her work on Paleolithic art in Romania and Moldova in a 2008 book, while consolidating her research on personal ornaments in the North Danube region in a 2019 book. A particular focus of her studies of hard osseous material has been the Iron Gates Mesolithic and Neolithic, and she has made good use of restudying all the material from key sites such as Skela Kladovei, the Cernica Cemetery, and Pietrele. Her key innovations in the study of bone tools and ornaments have been the experimental approach and the study of use wear, leading to co-edited volumes on Beauty and the Eye of the Beholder, Personal Ornaments Across the Millennium in 2020, and on Experimental Archaeology 2022 with Adina Boronianz, with whom she also co-edited the Clive Bonsall Festschrift in 2017. Monica has been assiduous in participating in both international and Romanian conferences and workshops, a total now approaching 100, and has indeed organized 3 international meetings. She has been a member of the EAS in 2011 and the GDRE Bone and Antler Research Group since 2011, and the AURANA, the Wear and Experimental Archaeology Group, since 2012. In today's presentation, Monica will be bringing together the multiple strands of her bone tool and ornament research in her talk entitled An Overview of the Osseous Industry from the Early Neolithic to the Chalcolithic in the Lower Danube Basin. Monica, we are very much looking forward to your talk.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much for your introduction. And I would like to thank for the invitation to present my research as part of the North Pontic Lecture Series. I also thank the colleagues present for their interest in prehistoric bone industries. My lecture is an overview of the osseous industries from the early Neolithic to the Chalcolithic at the Lower Danube. There will be a lot to say on this topic, but as time is limited, I have selected the details that I thought were important. Our presentation will briefly review the evolution of the osseous industries as a Lower Danube area between the 7th and 5th millennium BC. Within the various cultural phases, we discuss the composition of the bone industries, looking for specific innovations or the conservation of certain typological and technological patterns. Innovation-wise, we attempted to identify the moments of appearance and abandonment to determine if they represent a real technological progress and whether their appearance was triggered by the presence of cultural determinants or don't know, technological constraints. The Pleistocene Holocene transition at the Lower Danube was marked by an economy based on hunting and gathering reflected at the level of osseous industry by the selection of blanks deriving exclusively from wild animals. There may be identified variations along the different evolution phases regarding the ratio of one species of another or of types of raw materials, but they coincide with the variations identified at the level of the fauna remains. The osseous industry, especially present in sites placed in the area of the Danube Gorge, is characterized by the significant number of tools made of Cervus elaphus antler, followed by those made of long bones of large mammals and subspecies tusk. The typological composition consists of axes, hoes, mattocks, pigs, all made of antlers. The bone industry was represented by various types of awls and spear points, bevel tools, and spatulas, while from Sus species tusks were made especially scrapers and bevel tools. We must also mention the impressive quantity of debitage waste of antlers, illustrating a production in situ of the pieces. First farmers originating in the Near East and penetrating Europe, encountering hunter-gatherer communities exhibiting various subsistence patterns. The contacts between such various economies and thus Neolithization itself are reflected, among others, by the osseous industry. When compared to the previous Mesolithic period, there are changes in the raw materials, typology, and technology. The oldest Neolithic assemblages in this area belong to the Starcevo-Criș-Chioroș culture. For Romania, the dates falls between 6,000 and 5,300 calibrated BC, also a handful of dates fall outside both ends of the interval. The most interesting archaeological assemblage originates from Măgura Buduiască, South Romania, especially since a chronological sequence from the early Neolithic to the Chalcolithic is present here, with a Starcevo-Criș first phase between 6,100 and 5,900 calibrated BC. And Starcevo-Criș first phase between 5,800 and 5,700 calibrated BC. The main typological category is that of the pointed tools. A varied range of procedures was used to obtain the blank by partition, by grooving and percussion, successive partition by percussion. But the most interesting is a case of the bipartition by abrasion, innovation that does not appear in previous cultural stages and what widespread in Europe throughout the Neolithic period. As an observation, the projectile points are missing in the south of the Carpathians, all pointed tools being used in domestic activities. Instead, projectile points are attested in Starcevo sites in Serbia. They were discovered in large quantities at the sites of Starcevo and Donia Branievina. Fish hooks were also found in the both sites, which also do not appear south of the Carpathians. The spatulas show great uniformity, both in terms of raw materials, large mammals predominate, and technologically. For those on a flat blank, the bipartition of the rib by percussion to place followed by the shaping operation. In the case of the few spatulas on the blanking volume, the technological investment was minimal with arrangement of the active end by percussion, superimposed by abrasion. There also are also rings made both on flat blanks and blanking volume. In the first case, they were made from the diaphysis wall of mammal bones. To the center of the piece, a perforation with a conical morphology was carried out. For the rings on the blanking volume, the technological procedure started by marking the cementation level with a flint tool. During a second stage of finish, to finish the cementation procedure, either a flint tool or vegetable fiber was used. As from the same category of adornments, cylindrical beads. Also, on flat blank and or blanking volume, appear for the first time in Central and Northern Balkans. These new ornament types represent a tradition that originated in the Near East. The spoons were made on tibia, metapodia, or ribs of large mammals because in this case, wide blanks are needed. The flat blanks seems to have been obtained by a method of longitudinal bipartition achieved by grooving. The specific concavity of a receiving element was obtained by longitudinal scraping. The handle has a circular section, stemmed by a scraping applied around the entire circumference, and in a few cases was decorated. Specialists consider them as part of the Neolithic package. There are also handles made by removing the epiphysis through a cementation procedure by sewing with a flint tool. The medullary canal was used for gloving. The needles are on flat blank obtained by bipartition in double grooving or in successive partition, also with intervention of grooving technique. Postaurus or Ovisarius capra hircus astragalus were transformed by the abrasion of one or two sides. The study of the archaeological assemblages led to the identification as detachment procedures of a transversal debitage to which a transformation scheme by cementation is subordinated, and a longitudinal debitage with the following variants: transformation scheme by extraction, by bipartition, by quadripartition, and a scheme of transformation by successive partitions. To them is added a scheme of transformation by direct shaping, identified in the case of worked astragalus and of bones with scraping marks. Transversal debitage was done by direct sewing and percussion. The sewing was made both with flint tools and with the help of abrasive fibers. You can see in this picture. Longitudinally, for bipartition procedures, abrasion, percussion, double grooving and combination between grooving and sewing or grooving and percussion were used, while for successive partition, percussion was used. As part of the surface modification procedures, scraping and abrasion were used both. To change the volume, the perforation made by rotation or by carotage were used. In this last case, a tool with a hollow inside was used, resulting in a debris with a cylindrical morphology. You can see in these pictures. As I said above, other raw materials were little exploited. In the case of antler, the massive pieces from the Mesolithic is completely missing. Reminiscence of that period seems to be the harpoons. They are made on a flat blank without being able to reconstruct the debitus procedures. The barbs were created by sawing and the surface was regularized by scraping. Other typological categories are bevel tools or pointy tools. They are made on flat blank, obtained by cutting the antler longitudinally. At the distal level, an abrasion was applied on the lower side for bevel tools or bilaterally for pointy tools. The teeth are transformed into pendants, such as the Cervus elaphus canines, the Bostaurus incisor, or the Suscrofa canines. In these schemes, sometimes by recycling scrapers. Scrapers and bevel tools made from Suscrofa canines come from the Mesolithic tradition. The tools were made on blanks obtained by splitting the canine longitudinally. The cutting edges were adjusted by abrasion over variable areas. The active end with a concave edge was created by scraping. For the bevel tools, the active end was created by the transversal scraping of the distal extremity. The shells were selected from the local species of small gastropods like Lithoglyphus naticoides and Theodoxus danubialis, or from the marine species Columbella rustica, which through perforation were transformed into adornments. For the first time, union species bivalves are perforated. Ornaments from exotic materials also begin to appear, Spondylus or Glycimeris, processed into bracelets, or Antalis, processed into tubular beads coming from the Mediterranean area, probably in an already finished form. The Dudecht culture between 5,500 and 4,800 Kalibeti BC, and later a Boyan culture, follows the Starchevo Krish as a lower Danube. Almost contemporary with the Boyan culture, the Hamangia culture evolved in the territory between the Danube and the Black Sea. For the Dudecht culture, the dating from Măgura Buduiasca settlement provided ages between 530 and 5,470 Kalibeti BC and between 5,380 and 530 Kalibeti BC. And a series of data between 5,355 and 5,220 Kalibeti BC and between 5,190 and 5,080 Kalibeti BC have been published for the necropolis of Cernica. For the Dudecht culture, the bones from the Bostaurus species are in first place, closely followed by the Ovis aries Capra hircus species. Suscrofa canines or Cervus elaphus and Capreolus capreolus antlers were also used, but in a reduced proportion. As in the Starchevo-Krish culture, we see the same preponderance of bone coming from the domestic species. The typology is varied, with the same typological categories that appear in the Starchevo-Krish culture, to which are added new categories that will persist until the beginning of the Chalcolithic. Pointy tools are the most important typological abrasion disappear. The spatulas were processed on flat blank or blanking volume using the ribs of large mammals, both Taurus, Cervus, Elaphus. The third typological category is that of the spumes that followed the same technological scheme of transformation as the pieces from the previous culture. In the Dudesh culture, the rings made on two types of blanks continue to appear. Of these, one piece from Magura Buduyaska settlement deserves our full attention. It is a fragment burnt black, provided with an anthropomorphic decorative element. The scraped bones are represented by various blanks, humerus, metacarpus, metatarsus, belonging to large mammals, both Taurus, both Primigenius, Cervus elaphus. Technologically, we are talking about the existence of one or more rectilinear area clearly delimited, created by a deep scraping. Some pieces are considered belt element. It presents, from a morphological point of view, a rectangular proximal part with a V-shaped end and a circular distal part. The pieces are made on a flat blank, without being able to identify the debitage procedure because the debitage edges were rigorously abraded. At the distal level, the perforation was made by carotage, having a cylindrical morphology. The hairpins can be attributed rather to ornaments, especially through the fineness of the realization. It is an intact piece with an elaborate decoration. The pattern was created by a deep sawing, while the rest of the pattern were made by scraping. Some of these pieces are exceptional. Two such hairpins present towards the extremity a stylized feminine figure whose anatomical details were outlined by sawing and grooving. The surface of the items were finally shaping. Also appeared a series of pieces with a ring-like morphology, partially before fastening on a piece of clothing. They were made on a flat blank, obtained through a method of longitudinal debitage. The entire surface of the items were shaped generally by scraping followed by abrasion. Perforations present a cylindrical morphology resulting from rotation followed by a perforation enlargement by scraping. Cervus elaphus canines are present and they have been minimally modified with only a perforation carried out, allowing for their attachment. The subscrofa teeth were transformed into below beads, illustrating the use of another raw material in order to imitate the pieces made of spondylus. From this raw material, they have also made pendants on a flat blank obtained by longitudinal bipartition and abrasion of the debitage edges. They were further perforated and turned into ornaments. There also is a wide variety of adornments made from the spondylus bivalve, bilobed, trilobed beads, tubular, fusiform and biconvex beads, belt elements, bracelets. The inventory is completed by Glycimeris bracelets and Antalis tubular beads. Most pieces come from funerary contexts. During the period of maximum extension, the Boyan culture was present in the south of the Carpathians and in Bulgaria. For the settlement at Căscioarele Ostrovele, there is a date between 5210 and 4903 calibrated BC. Then for the Sultana Ghețărie site, the habitation is between 4956 and 4654 calibrated BC, while at Radovanu site, radiometric data indicated an age between 4852 and 4537 calibrated BC. The osseous industry obtained its raw materials from both domestic and wild animal species, as well as from imported shells. An extremely diverse range of bone skeletal element was exploited. Also, there was much lower variability in the species selection. We identified a constant in the selection of the species, which are predominantly domestic. Both Taurus comprises 40% of the total processed bones, along with Ovis aries capra hircus at 14%. These percentages correspond to the archaeological results, which identified over 90% domestic species among the fauna remains, in which both Taurus holds first place. As for the high proportion of artifacts made from antler, since in Boyan communities, hunting is thought to have had a secondary role in the economy compared to animal breeding, the high number of Cervus elaphus antlers, representing in some assemblages more than half of all the artifacts, may be explained primarily by collecting activities. Here is a first break with the early Neolithic archaeological assemblages, where few pieces made of deer antler were present. The most important category is that of bevel tools, whether they are made of bone or antler. Most bone bevel tools are on a flat blank. To obtain the blank, percussion was applied to produce a longitudinal bipartition of the bone. However, quite sporadically, bipartition through double grooving also appears. The active front and development was carried out either by bifacial abrasion or by scraping. The antler bevel tools were processed mostly on the tine, to a lesser extent on the beam, which preserves a blanking anatomic volume and has a perforation intended for holding at its proximal level. The proximal end shows a segmentation procedure by percussion. We identified two main procedures meant to develop the active end, bifacial development by longitudinal scraping, which provides convergence of two sides, and unifacial development by percussion, sometimes followed by abrasion. A perforation was achieved by bifacial rotation. Quantitatively, it follows pointed tools made of bone. This typological category was created by putting into practice several types of operational schemes of different complexity. The methods of debitage were bipartition or successive partition until one quarter of the original diameter was reached. These methods were implemented primarily by percussion procedure, followed by grooving and indirect percussion, or by double grooving. The active end development was carried out either by longitudinal scraping or by abrasion. The other common typological categories in the previous stages are also present: needles, spatulas, processed astragalus, or scraped bones. For antler, we mentioned pointed tools, hammers, handles, or pendants. The harpoon start to reappear, which will multiply in the next chronological stage. In the Boyan settlements, and especially in the necropolis, ornaments made of a spondylus shell have been found, from small cylindrical beads to belt elements and massive bracelets. The below beads were recovered from the necropolises of Andolina, Sultana Amarul Roșu, Sultana Valea Orbului, and in the settlement of Isaccea Suhat. Tubular, fusiform, and biconvex beads were found in the necropolises of Andolina, Sultana Valea Orbului, în Grădiștea Ulmilor Boian. Spondylus bracelets were made, such as those from the necropolises of Grădiștea Ulmilor Boian or Sultana Valea Orbului. Belt elements are also present, both from spondylus shell, but also imitation from other materials, clay, such as those from the Sultana Valea Orbului necropolis. Tubular Antalis shell beads were discovered in the Andolina necropolis. Pieces with a ring-like morphology made of bone, as we have seen in the previous cultural phases, are present in the necropolis of Sultana Valea Orbului. For the Hamangia culture, the radiocarbon dates indicate the period between 5,200 and 4,500 calibrated BC, a time interval inferred from absolute dates obtained for the settlement at Chea, between 5,214 and 4,961 calibrated BC to 5,047 and 4,855 calibrated BC. And for the necropolis of Cernavodă, between 5,367 and 5,215 calibrated BC to 4,959 and 4,749 calibrated BC. The archaeological study confirms the pastoral character of the economy indicated by the high percentage of domestic animals, over 90%, especially cattle and caprines. The SES industry reflects the economy type of this community, clearly oriented towards the exploitation of Ovis aries, Capra hircus, and Bos taurus bones. Typologically, pointed tools predominate. They are made especially on blanks resulting of the longitudinal debitage of the bone. As a procedure, the quadripartition in double grooving was used. And the needles were made by the same method of longitudinal debitage. In addition, they are provided with a perforation made by bifacial rotation. In the Hamangia settlement, there are also pieces in intermediate stages of processing that allows the reconstruction of the quadripartition procedure in double grooving. Another interesting category is that of the hammers made of Bos taurus, metatarsus or metacarpus. At the level of the epiphysis, important detachment of ore cracks developed on the surface are evident. Some pieces were intensively used so that in some areas a spongy tissue was reached, giving the extremity a rounding morphology. A category of pieces, the function of which could not be established, consists of fragments of Bos taurus ribs that preserve on one side transverse grooves made by pressure. They are blanks in volume that do not present other interventions of a technological nature. Even a spatula, also made of Bos taurus ribs, shows such grooves. There are also some scrape bones, also present in previous stages. Under the microscope, fine longitudinal striations are visible, resulting from a scraping process over which a medium intensity polish is superimposed. Antler working was sporadic. Bean settlements, such as the one at Cairn, where there are no pieces made of antler. Instead, the union species shells were used through as tools in domestic activities. They were used without any technological interventions, using the ventral edge, most likely for the shaping of ceramics. Also, the tortoise carapaces were probably used as containers. The personal ornaments are represented by spondylocheles transformed into various items, tubular, biconvex, cylindrical beads, trilobites, buttons, perforated plates, pendants, bracelets. Antallis tubular beads are also present. Such ornaments appear especially in funerary contexts. In the settlement, there are many borings made on Blanky volume. It is significant that the recovered artifacts belong to different stages of manufacturing, thus allowing for the reconstruction of the entire technological scheme. Cementation was carried out using a flint artifact, but it was completed by sawing with abrasive fiber. The cementation edges were shaped by abrasion, while the medullary canal was enlarged by scraping. Cardium shells perforated by abrasion in the area of the ambo also appear. The chalcolithic communities of the Kojadermen Gumelnica 6, Gumelnica Caranovo 6 cultural complex is spanning considerably over a large geographical area in Southeast Europe from the Carpathian Mountains to the Aegean Sea. During the period between 4,500 and 3,900 calibrated BC. This was documented at various tell settlements. For instance, at Hrshova, radiocarbon dates indicated the interval of from 4,686 to 4,486 calibrated BC. At Sultana Maluroșu, human occupation was indicated for the intervals of 4,539 and 4,365, and between 4,164 and 3,961 calibrated BC. In the main sites belonging to the Gumelnica culture, the percentages of pieces made of antler and board are close. A wide variety of tools were made from antler: bevel tools, harpoons, composite tools, hammers, spear points, and pointy tools, pressure flakers. The most numerous are bevel tools. We are mainly talking about massive items from basal areas or from beams. Obtaining the blank was done through a cementation procedure by direct percussion. A rectangular perforation was created by facial cutting, which ensured the transversal gloving. The active end was arranged with longitudinal percussion. For the specimens made of tin, the cementation was performed by percussion. The perforation was made by cutting, percussion and percussion combined with rotation. The active end was arranged by percussion, followed in some cases by the abrasion of the end. Bevel tools were made also on flat blank, obtained through longitudinal bipartition by percussion. The regularization of the debitage edge was created by abrasion, extending on variable surfaces depending on the item. For these specimens, the arrangement of the active end was made with bifacial abrasion. The manufacturing of harpoons, according to the observed antler debitage, involves several important procedures. Surface regularization after having obtained the blank, cutting out the particular elements, barbs, protuberances, point, and delineating the final shapes through finishing. During manufacturing, antler was cut longitudinally, but the technique remains obscure due to subsequent technological intervention. Detachment of the barbs and protuberances from the proximal end was carried out by sawing. The ends were sharpened by scraping, applying around the entire circumference. The so-called composite tools have a similar morphology, but their functionality raises questions. At the distal level, the items have a pointy morphology with a curved profile and a plane convex section. At the proximal level, they were usually provided with a barb and a perforation with a cylindrical, circular morphology. All the pieces were made on the tines through its longitudinal bipartition. At the proximal level, a model by alternative bifacial cutting was released prior to shaving of most specimens because the cutting marks are no longer visible. Towards the proximal end, a bifacial rotation perforation was arranged. Both extremities were created by bilateral scraping covered by the final shaping. Hammers were used in percussive actions. They are generally made from the basal area of shed antlers or antlers cut from the skull. The outer bar have been removed and the surface was shaped. A perforation with a rectangular morphology was created. The active area bears various cuts. Pressure flakers were made from tines. The cementation was done by percussion and the pieces were minimal shaped by scraping or percussion. Towards the pointed end, there are deep, irregularly arranged incisions resulting from contact with the flint tools. Also, from the gumelita size comes spear point varied in morphology. Most are splinters of compact tissue whose surface had been shaped by scraping. They feature different glove systems. Other pieces come from the tip of the tines. The glove system generally consists of a perforation. The typological series of bone pieces are also varied. Bevel tools, pointed tools, projectile points, spatulas, abraded astragalus, spindle walls, figurines, rectangular plates. Bevel tools were made either on blank in volume, besides for the gumelita culture, are bevel tools made of hollow. I think you've seen these pictures. The technological investment is minimal, using the natural shape of the bone, as it can be seen that the proximal epiphyses were removed by percussion without irregularization of the debitages. Then at the distal level, a new percussion blow was given, the regularization being achieved by bifacial abrasion. More numerically important is a category of bevel tools made on flat blank. The debitage procedures are varied by partition, quadripartition, or successive partition by percussion. The active end was created by uni or bifacial abrasion. Most of the pointed tools are on flat blanks. In this category, in the bipartition or longitudinal quadripartition procedure, double grooving was used quite often. The debitage sites were regularized on variable surfaces. The pointed end was prepared by scraping or abrasion or a combination of the two techniques. Various projectile points were made from the bone, same as unique specimen, like in this case. They offer different types of glass systems. They are splinters from the diaphyseal wall of some long bones, but we don't know the methods of debitage. The surface had been carefully shaped for spatulas. According to the morphology of the active end, we identify three types of spatulas: straight, convex, and pointed. To obtain the straight spatulas, the longitudinal debitage in percussion was applied. The debitage edges and the inferior side have been regularized by scraping or by abrasion applied to variable surfaces. For the convex spatulas, the bone was sectioned longitudinally by partition. Afterwards, the debitage edges and the entire inferior side were rigorously abraded. To obtain the pointed spatulas, the blank was obtained by a longitudinal debitage with the shaping of the edges by abrasion. Figurines were made from the diaphyses of large mammal bones. In general, it is not possible to reconstitute debitage procedures. The blanks were rigorously shaped, and the anatomical elements were cut by sewing. Most of them have perforations or dots on the head, some illustrating wear, use wear. Also, other anatomical elements, pubic triangle, legs, feet, are reproduced on the surface of the pieces, along with other decorative elements consisting of rows of dots or various incisions. Obvious areas, Capra hircus, astragalus, and Bostaurus astragalus, underwent an abrasion procedure on one or more faces, which resulted in the flattening of the surface. Some specimens were perforated by rotation. For the spindle whorls, most of the items were made from the femoral head of both Taurus or Cervus elaphus species. The detachment from the bone was achieved by indirect percussion because the fracture plane is smoothed, preserving the negative of the active front of the intermediate piece. Centrally, a rotation perforation was performed from both sides because their profile is biconical. Needles with a bilobate morphology were also discovered at Gumelnica settlements. The bilobate morphology was created by sawing followed by abrasion of the surface. The pointed end was created by longitudinal scraping applied around the entire circumference followed by abrasion. Another typological category present at the Gumelnica settlement is that of perforated plates. Most likely, they were sewn on clothes because they showed deformation of the perforations, and one of their faces is usually affected by use wear. The initial technological procedures are identical at all specimens: a flat blank obtained from the diaphysis of a long bone. Despite the fact the contour was abraded at all items, fractures resulting from the percussion are still visible, demonstrating that, at least in the longitudinal direction, a percussion method was used. Along the transversal direction, segmentation by sawing was probably applied to obtain blanks with predetermined shapes and dimensions. The traces of this action were overlapped in this case by abrasion. At the center, all pieces have perforations made by bifacial rotation. For the Gumelica culture, perforated shells of Lithoglyphus naticoides are present as a tell settlement as well as in the necropolis of Sultana Maru Roshan. The archaeological pieces were perforated, probably using indirect percussion. Modified shells belonging to the Chaldean species were identified. All the pieces are perforated on the area of the ambo. Personal adornments made of Unios species shells are attested frequently for Gumelnica settlements. These have been transformed into circular beads. We identify pieces in various transformation stages, from irregular splinters to finished beads. The latter have been used as personal adornments assembled into composite ornaments, such as bracelets or necklaces. Opercular bones of Cyprinus scalpium were transformed into adornments as a test settlement of Hrshova. The assemblage consists of 69 items in different stages of processing. The finished items have the same circular shape as the union shell ornaments. During the Gumelica culture, the numerical weight of spondylus ornaments is much higher in necropolises than in settlements. There are three types of personal adornments present. Beads, especially circular, tubular, and biconvex, bracelets, and pendants. In settlements, even if in limited numbers, we find a perforated plate. You can see in these pictures. Belt elements, tubular and circular beads, pendants, bracelets, tubular beads made from Antalis shells are mentioned. At Gumelica settlements and necropolises, they are perforated plates made from Suscrofa canines. The fashion of wearing such perforated plates is attested as a necropolis of Kinoshuvica lui Urgules, where two graves yielded two triangular and seven rectangular items in one case and seven rectangular items for the second. And finally, between 4,500 and to 3,500 calibrated BC, the Cucut and Tripilian techno complex was covering present-day Moldova, northeastern and eastern Romania, and western, central, and southern Ukraine. According to the radiocarbon data, the Cucuten first phase involves between 4,530 and 4,385 calibrated BC and between 4,260 and 4,015 calibrated BC. This culture is known for its distinct, beautifully painted pottery and elaborate anthropomorphic and animal figurines. Within the archaeological assemblages, the pieces made of from Cervus elaphus antler are in first place. The most important category is that of bevel tools, having varied morphology. There are massive specimens made from branches coming from shed entrance or detaching from the skull or beams, preserving the anatomical volume. The active end was created by percussion. Some items are provided with perforations made by bifacial percussion and completed by bifacial rotation. There were end items on flat blanks obtained by longitudinal bipartition in percussion or extraction by double grooving. The active front was created either by percussion or scraping. Pressure flakers, blanks, were made on tines. Volume was preserved and detachment was carried out by percussion around the entire circumference, followed by a combination between percussion and bending or directly by bending. No other interventions of technological nature were identified. The presence of use marks allowed for the functional classification. Spoons are characterized by the presence of a receptacle continuing with a narrow segment representing the handle. All specimens were made on flat blanks, obtaining from beam segments. Longitudinal bipartition procedure cannot be identified because the edges were regularized by abrasion. The active front was created by cutting, followed by abrasion. The inferior side was completely cleaned of the spongy tissue and regularized by longitudinal scraping. Containers were made using the basal area of the shed antler. It was trimmed by percussion, followed by scraping. All spongy tissue was removed by scraping also. From bone, pointy tools, spoons, scrapers, and bevel tools were made. The pointy tools represent the most important typological category of the specimens where we could identify the techniques of the debitage operation. The most numerous were made on flat blanks by quadri partition in double grooving, less often by bipartition in double grooving. There are also specimens made from splinters of the diaphyseal wall obtained by direct percussion. At most specimens, the debitage edges were remained unshaped, and abrasion was used only on a few specimens. Some items were made on blanking volume. At the distal end, the tip was created by abrasion, scraping, or a combination of the both techniques. Spoons are made on flat blanks obtained by longitudinal bipartition. The specific techniques could not be determined as the debitage edges were regularized by longitudinal scraping or abrasion. The inferior face were cleaned of the spongy tissue by longitudinal scraping. As the specimens ending in a thin rod used the handle, the circular receptacle was created by longitudinal scraping followed by abrasion. Scrapers on scapulas of both taurus make an interesting typological category. The active front was created by cutting using bifacial grooving carried down until the wall was sufficiently thin, followed by bending. As an observation, in the Cucutian sites, we did not identify the very range of ornaments and especially ornaments made of exotic materials, as we have seen in previous cultures. In the site, products and subproducts of the technological scheme in various stages of processing, extremely useful in our analysis, were identified. and are precisely resulting in two types of blanks, in volume and blank. There is a predilection for blanks in volume because massive items were made that required such blanks. The debitage products, blanks and waste, and the finished pieces allowed for the identification of the following detachment procedures: a transversal debitage triggering a segmentation sequence, and longitudinal debitage triggering a bipartition sequence, and an extraction one. In the first case, the techniques used are direct percussion, followed by segmentation using abrasive fibers or with a flint tool, and bending. In the case of the longitudinal debitage, the technique holding is percussion. During the extraction sequence, awling grooving was used. Two types of blanks were used for bone processing: volume and flat. In contrast to antler, it is visible the predilection for the use of flat blanks when compared to volume ones. The detachment procedures identified were transversal debitage, triggering a segmentation sequence associated especially with volume blanks, longitudinal debitage triggered multiple possibilities, a quadripartition sequence, a bipartition sequence, a removal by percussion sequence, and a shaping sequence. In the first case, the techniques used are direct percussion, grooving, followed by sawing, longitudinal debitage. The predominant technique is double grooving, used in both bi and quadri partition, followed by percussion and the combination of grooving and percussion. In conclusion, this is extremely brief review of CSS industry's evolution in the geographic area under analysis, yet it highlights strong convulsions under the impulse of a multitude of factors, among which the cultural and environmental ones probably had a considerable weight. However, we were able to capture the general picture of the composition of the OCS industries in terms of raw materials, typology, and technology. Thus, for the early Neolithic, the presence of several elements related to Mesolithic traditions draws attention: harpoons, radiocanized, used as pendants, teeth scrapers. New elements also appear, both technologically, such manufactured by wear techniques, like bipartition through abrasion, cementation with abrasive fiber and perforation by wear technique, and typologically, new categories like spoons, rings or bones with scraping marks, abraded astragalus that belong entirely lead to the Neolithic. Another specific element valid from the early Neolithic to the beginning of the Chalcolithic is a minimal exploitation of deer antlers and boar canines in favor of the bones from domestic species. In the Middle Neolithic, we observe a continuity with the starch of Ocriș culture with the early Neolithic, both at typological and technological levels. However, among the defining elements for the Neolithization process, we notice that the pointed tools obtained by bipartition through abrasion no longer appear in this phase either. At the typological level, the previous typological categories are maintained alongside with which new ones appear, like belt elements or hairpins. Next, the antler is slightly exploited. Starting with the Chalcolithic, and especially at the level of the Gumelita and Cucuten cultures, important transformations take place at the level of the raw materials and typology. We are witnessing a return of antler that equals or even exceeds the number of bone pieces. The massive pieces, such as bevel tools, reappear as they are also existing in the Mesolithic, and various types of projectile points and harpoons used in hunting. Thank you very much for your attention.